I did the work. First, I want to thank One Voice and Glenn. That was wonderful. That was just really great. Got more to look forward to. Thank you. And then I want to thank the audience for being here, because it's just great to look at it and see us changing the world together. It's our Pastor Miles in the audience. Okay. He was planning to be out of town because he was speaking at a national conference, and his father died last week, so he is in town, and he said he might try to stop, so if he should appear to somebody waving, so I want to acknowledge him. And just want to share, King's Dream is so exciting, but living it out is challenging. Because here, I live on Plantation Road. The theme of my high school yearbook was the old site. We had a section that said, it was one of those, you know, where they write, and it said, remember the days when we would sit on the porch and sip mint juleps while the Negroes worked in the fields? So that's my legacy in 1961. That was me. And so then Larry Miles grew up in this neighborhood, disenfranchised, and yet he rose and broke through the boundaries. Somehow, by the grace of God, I feel like I am escaping from the roots that kept me confined to a way of thinking, to be able to walk hand in hand. But it's still every day of working it out. And that's why I'm so excited to have Brian Blunt with us tonight. I told him I wanted to sell all of his books. If you haven't read his books, you need to go buy his books. He's a really incredible writer. So yay. Now, I haven't read them all, but I've read a lot of them. My very favorite, I carry it around like sort of like my extra Bible, is Preaching Mark in Two Voices. And he teamed up with a white pastor from a very established church, and together they took our Lord's words and the story of Jesus through the eyes of Mark. And how do we look at it from our own cultural perspective? And it is such an exciting book, because it has a Jesus by one, and then a sermon, and then a rebuttal by the other, all taking all the way through the book of Mark. So I share that because I'm getting ready to read something from that book, because it really impacts me as we try to listen together, because it's only Jesus that lets us to be able to break these boundaries and brings us here tonight. But how do we do it? We've got to work it out. And that's that way we're co-creating with God. It's figuring out how to get along in a new way and how to move beyond the broken way that we lived. But in one of his sermons, Coming Home, and he spoke it to his family reunion, but it fits us. It was referring to the passage, I didn't look this up, I tried to tell which way it was, but it's in Mark when Jesus says, the disciples say, your mother's here. And he says, you know, these are my brothers and sisters, pointing to people around him, not to the blood of relatives and sisters. And so it's a chapter about how God makes us into new families. And I think it just fits tonight, all of us here in this new family. Jesus takes old families and recycles them into a new family. He's about creating the kind of family he believes God wants. So he shakes up the family that is until he shakes out the kind of family that ought to be. You want to know why a family is united and reunited? Jesus believes it for the purpose of conquering evil wherever it's found, bringing wholeness wherever there is brokenness, teaching wherever someone needs to learn. Family units, that's us, become change units. Family love becomes love for justice and hope. And family reunion and gatherings like this become times to plot the strategy for changing the world around them. So I introduce you to a fellow world changer, and let's give this member of our family, Brian Blunt, a hand.
Pleasure for me to be here to share with you this evening. I'm delighted to be a part of the celebration that's connected with Boaz and Ruth, and to be here with Martha Rollins, who is one of my heroes in faith, and I'm always delighted in whatever capacity I'm able to share with her whenever I get the opportunity. So it's a delight to be invited by her to be here and to have this chance to speak with you on this occasion of celebrating the work of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. During speeches in honor of Dr. King, have always been a little bit difficult for me. Not because I don't want to celebrate Dr. King, I do. I give praise and thanks for him continually. The difficulty comes because I do not want to do what King himself did not want to do, and that is glorify a man when the more appropriate goal is to glorify the God who called and inspired the man to do what he did for God's people. And so to that end, this evening I'd like to do what King himself most often did, interpret from the text of King's own faith tradition the message that King believed as God shared with him as he worked for God's people. What does a portion of that word mean for us today as we contemplate following in King's footsteps? What does a portion of that word mean for us as we share with the community of Boaz and Ruth that has coordinated this communal service? And using the text of King's own tradition and mine, I do not mean to be exclusive, but rather to share how this very particular faith message had for King then and has for us today universal transforming possibilities. In this spirit, then, let us contemplate a biblical text as perhaps Martin Luther King Jr. might have contemplated it as a word for us today. They came to Capernaum, and when Jesus was in the house, he asked them, "What are you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. He sat down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last and servant of all." Then he took a little child and put it among them, and taking it in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes not me, but the one who sent me." John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name. We tried to stop him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a deed of power in my name will be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. Whoever is not against us is for us." Now, demons caused all sorts of problems in the world when Jesus walked this earth. They broke through human mental and physical defenses. Like thieves in the night, they stole in and inhabited the human psyche. Then they drained all of the human strength and personality they could find. They were hostile, malignant, parasitic forces. Once they took hold, they ate up human being the way a locked-on leech drinks down human blood. They took away the most precious thing a person has, his or herself. In its place, they left a mean-spirited, twisted wrecking ball of psychological fury. Some of the demon-possessed went crazy, others went violently and gravely ill, many of them died. It is no wonder, then, that the exorcists of Jesus' day were in high demand. In first century Palestine, there was a bull market on madness. This is one of the reasons Jesus is so popular in the Gospel of Mark. He is an exorcist extraordinaire. Jesus wields exorcism the way a soldier swings a sword. It is one of the most lethal weapons in his power arsenal of the kingdom of God. According to Mark, it is a weapon that Jesus shared with his disciples. And that's the point. The power to exorcise is a power Jesus gave to all of his disciples. The word to Jesus' followers is clear. We are all of us exorcists here.